Today, Apple has the largest and most diverse product ecosystem in history. From smartphones to tablets to smartwatches, we've never seen Apple compete in so many industries simultaneously. But with all these new products, it's easy to forget that Apple started as a computer company, and their Macintosh operating system, also known as macOS, has been around since 1984. So in this video, we're going to explore the history of macOS and find out how it's grown and evolved over the past four decades. This is Greg with Apple Explained, and I want to thank Squarespace for sponsoring this video. If you want to help decide which video topics I cover, make sure you're subscribed, and voting polls like this one will show up in your mobile activity feed. Now, as I mentioned, the beginnings of macOS go all the way back to 1984. That's when Apple introduced the Macintosh, which was the first commercial computer to feature a graphical user interface and mouse. This made the machines much easier to use and more accessible to people who may not be interested in technology. In fact, Apple's goal was to create a computer with appliance-like simplicity. And for that reason, there was no distinction made between the operating system software and the hardware it ran on. That meant early versions of macOS didn't have specific names. So to keep things simple, people began using system file version numbers to differentiate between the various OS iterations. First, there was Macintosh System Software 1 in 1984. It was introduced with the original Macintosh, which received one of the longest applause breaks in recorded history. This initial version was simply called Macintosh System Software, although a 1 was later added to the end as more iterations were released. System 1 introduced some incredibly powerful features that remain a crucial part of macOS to this day. Some of those included the Finder, a file manager responsible for launching applications, and the overall user management of files, disks, and network volumes. The menu bar was also a new and revolutionary part of the operating system. It had 5 basic headers when on the desktop: the Apple menu, file, edit, view, and special, although the menu bar options would change depending on the application in use. System 1 also featured 7 desk accessories like the alarm clock, a basic 10-button calculator, a control panel, keycaps, a notepad, a 15-piece slide puzzle, and scrapbook, which was like a cut, copy, and paste library. The difference between desktop accessories and applications was that multiple desktop accessories could run simultaneously, but only one application could run at a time. This was due to the limited RAM included with the Macintosh and the lack of an internal hard disk. Also, items in the trash were permanently deleted when the computer was shut down or a new application was loaded. System 2 added support for Apple Talk, which allowed a local network of Macintosh computers to be connected without the need for a centralized router or server. It also introduced support for the LaserWriter and added a hierarchical file system, which allowed file directories to be searched quickly regardless of size. System 3.0 was introduced with the Macintosh Plus, officially implementing HFS, 800K startup drives, support for several new technologies including SCSI, and AppleShare. System 4.0 was released with the Macintosh SE, and System 4.1 shipped with the Macintosh 2. These new machines required additional software support for their new expansion slots, Apple Desktop Bus, internal hard drives, external color displays, and the first Motorola processor. Towards the end of 1987, Apple introduced a package titled Apple Macintosh System Software Update 5.0. For the first time, the Macintosh operating system was offered as a distinct retail product that included 4 800K disks and 3 manuals at a cost of $49. The main feature of System 5 was MultiFinder, an extension which let the system run several applications at once, and Installer, a tool that could be used to update a previous system folder to a new version. System Software 5 was available for a short time and only in select countries. System Software 6 served as a consolidation release of the Macintosh system software, producing a complete, stable, and long-lasting operating system. One of the few features introduced in System 6 was a utility called Macro Maker. It allowed users to record mouse and keyboard inputs. In 1991, System 7 was released. It was a major upgrade that added a user interface overhaul, new applications, stability improvements, and many new features like built-in cooperative multitasking and the ability to create aliases, similar to shortcuts that were introduced in later versions of Microsoft Windows. Mac OS 8 was released in 1997, shortly after Steve Jobs returned to the company. It was mainly released to keep Mac OS moving forward during a difficult time for Apple. Initially planned as Mac OS 7.7, it was renumbered 8 to exploit a legal loophole and accomplish Jobs' goal of ending third-party licensing of System 7 and shutting down the Macintosh clone market. Mac OS 8 added a number of features from the abandoned Copeland project while leaving the underlying operating system unchanged. A multi-threaded finder was included so files could be copied in the background, the GUI was changed to a new shaded grayscale look named Platinum, and the ability to change the appearance themes, also known as skins, was added with a new control panel, though Platinum was the only theme shipped. Apple sold 1.2 million copies of Mac OS 8 in its first 2 weeks, and 3 million within 6 months. Because of Apple's financial difficulties at the time, there was a large grassroots movement among Mac users to upgrade and help save Apple. Even some pirate groups refused to redistribute the operating system. Mac OS 9, the last major revision of the early Macintosh operating system, was released in 1999. It added improved support for airport wireless networking, which allowed users to access the internet quickly and easily, since its popularity was exploding during this time. And while it was very difficult to get a website up and running in the late 90s, it's become much easier today with site builders like Squarespace. I actually started using Squarespace years ago to create AppleExplained.com, and I chose their platform since it has a super easy to use drag and drop interface and the most website templates to choose from compared to any other site builder. But what I thought was really cool is that I could add an e-commerce store to my site when I was selling merch a couple years ago without starting over from scratch. Plus, the payment processor was built in, and I could print shipping labels straight from Squarespace. But you can sell even more than physical items. It's also possible to sell digital items like ebooks and music, or services if you're a consultant or fitness coach. It really is an all-in-one platform designed to do almost anything you can imagine. And you can get all this for cheaper than you might think, especially if you use the link squarespace.com/appleexplained, since you'll get 10% off your first purchase. You can find that link in the description. Alright, now along with the wireless internet capabilities of Mac OS 9, it also added some transitional technologies to help application developers adopt some Mac OS 10 features before the introduction of the new OS to the public to help ease the transition. The final update to the classic Macintosh operating system was version 9.2.2, released at the end of 2001. Now, it was during this transition period when Apple revealed Mac OS X for the first time at the Macworld Expo in 2000. It was a radical change from the previous version, featuring an entirely new user interface called Aqua, which was influenced by the shiny, colorful iMac and iBook. Jobs said the design goal of Aqua was to make the buttons look so good you'll want to lick them. And I think they were successful. Mac OS X was a feast for the eyes, with its glossy buttons, pinstripes, and flashy animations. The problem was, all that visual luster came at the cost of performance. ARS Technia's John Syracuse called the Aqua UI unbearably slow and a huge resource hog. Now, Apple tried to remedy this issue before the public release of Mac OS X, but they were only partially successful. The first version was called Cheetah, and it began the trend of Apple naming each OS release after a different big cat. Now, despite Apple's best efforts, the Aqua UI in OS X Cheetah was still pretty slow compared to its competition, kernel panics were quite common, and the operating system was missing critical features like a DVD player, disk burning, and printer driver support. Later on in 2001, an incremental release called Mac OS 10.1 Puma was shipped to address the majority of concerns users had with Cheetah. It was not only faster, but certain elements were reorganized and streamlined, making the operating system more intuitive. Puma included features like DVD playback, disc burning, expanded printer support, and image capture for importing photos from a digital camera, which is still around today. Now, less than a year after that release, Apple was ready to give macOS 10 its first full-featured update called macOS 10.2 Jaguar. It was regarded as the first version of macOS 10 that pro users could push to its limits, the same way they could with macOS 9. And on posters of the disc artwork for Jaguar, the Roman numeral 10 featured 3D rendered fur thanks to some help from Pixar, where Steve Jobs also served as CEO. Along with many performance optimizations, Jaguar also included over 150 new user features, including MP4 support in QuickTime, junk mail flagging in the Mail app, and better compatibility with Windows. Now, a little over a year after Jaguar, the next update to macOS 10 arrived, this time called Panther. It was the most substantial release to date, with hundreds of new features including a redesigned Finder, Exposé for a one-click view of all active windows, and iChat AV, a video conferencing app. Panther also came with a bunch of updated or brand new applications like Fontbook for installing and browsing installed typefaces, Xcode for app development, and for the first time, Apple's own web browser called Safari. Previously, they were using a port of Microsoft's Internet Explorer. Once Safari was released, it paved the way for several other browsers to use its impressive open source WebKit framework, including Google Chrome in 2008. Now, Panther cost $130 for a single-use upgrade, which may seem pretty steep considering new releases of macOS today are free, but it was pretty reasonable compared to the price of other operating systems like Windows, which sold for about $200. The following release, macOS 10.4 Tiger, was really important for Apple, since it was used for the development of other products. Tiger powered the first Apple TV and served as the framework for the first iPhone operating system in 2007. It included over 200 new features like Spotlight Search, dashboard widgets, RSS support in Safari, a dictionary, and photo booth. Tiger was also the first release to support two types of processors, the legacy PowerPC architecture and the modern Intel architecture used in newer Macs. The Aqua user interface was also updated, with the pinstripes being replaced by more subtle glass and brushed stainless steel elements. Tiger was the longest running version of macOS 10, with 11 updates released over 3 years, beginning in 2005 and ending in 2007. And that's primarily due to OS 10 Leopard being delayed twice. Jobs said the OS would be released at the end of 2006 or beginning of 2007, and then changed the timeframe to spring 2007, and later pushed back the date again to October 2007. The cause of these delays was the iPhone, which took resources away from the Mac since it was also going to be released in 2007. Now, a few of Leopard's features were Time Machine, an improved mail app, iChat AV with photo booth filters, Spaces, which organize your windows into different desktops, support for 64-bit applications, a redesigned desktop and dock with more 3D elements and file stacks, Bootcamp for switching between macOS and Windows, and Quick Look, which allowed users to press the spacebar to preview something in Finder. macOS 10 Snow Leopard was the next update, and it's regarded by many to this day as the single best macOS 10 release ever. While the main appeal of Snow Leopard was its under-the-hood improvements, like a more responsive Finder rewritten in Cocoa, and sandboxed apps for more security, there were a number of visible improvements, like over 7 GB of recovered disk space when you upgraded from Leopard, a redesigned QuickTime 10, and the Mac App Store. I should also mention that Snow Leopard was the final version of macOS 10 to be exclusively released on physical disks, because starting with Lion in 2011, the operating system could only be updated via the Mac App Store, with the exception of Lion being available on a $70 USB drive for a short time. Now, speaking of macOS 10.7 Lion, it was actually a really pivotal release since it began the trend of borrowing features and apps from iOS. Things like AirDrop, FaceTime, push notifications, mail, and address book were really reminiscent of the iPad's interface, Most system apps gained autosave, full screen, and auto resume. There was system-wide implementation of autocorrect and emoji pickers, and multi-touch gestures were implemented across the entire operating system. And this prompted speculation over whether Apple might merge iOS and macOS into a single operating system, although the company has made it clear they plan on keeping them separate. Now, macOS 10.8 Mountain Lion further integrated iOS with the Mac in 2012 by introducing Notification Center, iMessage as a replacement for iChat, Game Center, Reminders, and Notes. Apps like Address Book and iCal were renamed Contacts and Calendar to match their iOS counterparts. And macOS 10.9 Mavericks was released a year later, with Craig Federighi joking on stage that they'd run out of big cat names for new versions of macOS 10, so they decided to use names of California landmarks instead, the first being Mavericks. Now, this release was fairly incremental, featuring improved performance and battery life for MacBooks, iCloud keychain to generate store and sync passwords and credit card numbers, tabbed windows and file tagging in Finder, the ability to take action on notifications directly inside the banner, and ported versions of iBooks and Maps. It was also the first version of macOS in history to be released for free through the Mac App Store. In 2014, macOS 10.10 Yosemite was introduced and featured a flatter user interface to more closely match the design of iOS 7, although it was pretty light on features. Handoff was added, which allowed you to seamlessly switch between devices when working on a document, and the Mac could be used to make or answer calls through your iPhone. In 2015, OS 10.11 El Capitan added the Metal API to make graphically intense apps run smoother, a new system-wide typeface called San Francisco, and public transit support in the Maps app. But the big update wouldn't arrive until 2016 with the release of macOS 10.12 Sierra. First, the name macOS 10 was simplified to macOS, adopting the same naming scheme as Apple's other operating systems like iOS, watchOS, and tvOS. Also, there were a lot of convenience features like Auto Unlock, which used your Apple Watch to quickly unlock your Mac rather than typing in a password every time, and Universal Clipboard, which used Wi-Fi and Bluetooth to share clipboard content between all devices using your Apple ID. There were also features like picture-in-picture mode for videos, night shift, Siri support, and the Apple file system. Now, the following update in 2017 was called High Sierra and introduced new features like HVEC video support, Metal 2, eGPU support for some Macs with Thunderbolt 3 ports, although most users wouldn't notice many visible differences in this version. But fortunately, that changed in 2018 with macOS Mojave, which introduced the much-anticipated dark mode, along with new dynamic wallpapers that changed depending on the time of day. Stacks were also added to the desktop to reduce clutter, FaceTime supported up to 32 people in a video call, the App Store was redesigned to match the changes made on iOS, and 4 iOS apps were ported to the Mac: News, Stocks, Voice Memos, and Home. Now, macOS 10 received its final update in 2019 with Catalina. It was the first version to drop support for 32-bit apps and featured Sidecar, which allowed an iPad to be used wirelessly as a second display, as well as support for PlayStation 4 and Xbox controllers. Mac Catalyst also made its debut, which allowed developers to write apps that could run on both macOS and iPadOS, as well as easily port apps from iPadOS to the Mac. Now, the most recent release of macOS, called Big Sur, happens to be one of the most important, and if you want a detailed explanation as to why, I dedicated a whole video to the topic, but in short, Big Sur marks the beginning of a completely new era for the Mac. Not only is it the first macOS 11 release, but it finally brings the Mac into the modern era of technology. Its interface has been completely transformed to closely match iOS and iPadOS with new rounded rectangular icons, Control Center, and Notification Center. But this update is more than skin deep. You see, Big Sur is the first macOS release to be optimized for Apple's custom-made ARM processors, which will be included in upcoming Macs. That means this update is laying the groundwork for a future where Macs, iPads, and iPhones are more deeply integrated than ever before. With ARM processors, Big Sur will run iOS and iPadOS apps natively, with no modifications needed from developers. Its graphics will be more powerful, the machine will run cooler and quieter, and battery life will be unmatched by any other notebook in the market. And while Big Sur itself may not be the most life-changing update, it's putting the Mac on an exciting path full of possibilities that I think many people could have never even imagined. Alright guys, thanks for watching till the end. Don't forget to subscribe to help decide which topics I cover, and I'll see you in the next video.